Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The last nail is being driven into the coffin of the American Republic. Yet Congress remains in total denial as our liberties are rapidly fading before our eyes. The process is propelled by unwarranted fear and ignorance as to the true meaning of liberty. It is driven by economic myths, fallacies, and irrational good intentions. The rule of law is constantly rejected, and authoritarian answers are offered as panaceas for all our problems. Runaway welfareism is used to benefit the rich at the expense of the middle class. Who would have ever thought that the current generation and Congress would stand idly by and watch such a rapid disintegration of the American Republic? Characteristic of this epic event is the casual acceptance by the people and the political leaders of the unitary presidency, which is equivalent to granting dictatorial powers to the president. Our presidents can now, on their own, order assassinations, including American citizens, operate secret military tribunals, engage in torture, enforce indefinite imprisonments without due process, order searches and seizures without proper warrants, gutting the Fourth Amendment, ignore the 60-day rule for reporting to the Congress the nature of any military operation as required by the War Power Resolution, continue the Patriot Act abuses without oversight, wage war at will, treat all Americans as suspected terrorists at airports with TSA groping and nude x-raying. And the Federal Reserve accommodates by counterfeiting the funds needed and not paid for by taxation and borrowing, permitting runaway spending, endless debt, and special interest bailouts. And all of this is not enough. The abuses and usurpations of the war power are soon to be codified in the National Defense Authorization Act, now rapidly moving its way through Congress. Instead of repealing the 2001 authorization for the use of military force, as we should, now that bin Laden is dead and gone, Congress is planning to massively increase the war power of the president. Though an opportunity presents itself to end the wars in Iraq, Afghanistan, and Pakistan, Congress, with bipartisan support, obsesses on how to expand the unconstitutional war power of the president he already holds. The current proposal would allow a president to pursue war anytime, any place, for any reason, without congressional approval. Many believe this would even permit military activity against American suspects here at home. The proposed authority does not reference the 9/11 attacks. It would be expanded to include the Taliban and associated forces, a dangerously vague and expansive definition of our potential enemies. There is no denial that the changes in Section 1034 totally eliminates the hard-fought-for restraint on presidential authority to go to war without congressional approval achieved at the Constitutional Convention. Congress's war authority has been severely undermined since World War II, beginning with the advent of the Korean War, which was fought solely under a UN resolution. Even today, we're waging war in Libya without even consulting with the Congress, similar to how we went to war in Bosnia in the 1990s under President Clinton. The three major reasons for our constitutional conventions were to guarantee free trade and travel among the states, make gold and silver legal tender, and abolish paper money, and strictly limit the executive branch's authority to pursue war without congressional approval. But today, Federal Reserve notes are legal tender, gold and silver are illegal. The Interstate Commerce Clause is used to regulate all commerce at the expense of the free trade among the states. And now, the final nail is placed in the coffin of congressional responsibility for the war power, delivering this power completely to the president, a sharp and huge blow to the concept of our republic. In my view, it appears that the fate of the American Republic is now sealed, unless these recent trends are quickly reversed. The saddest part of this tragedy is that all these horrible changes are being done in the name of patriotism and protecting freedom. They are justified by good intentions while believing the sacrifice of liberty is required for our safety. Nothing could be further from the truth. More sadly is the conviction that our enemies are driven to attack us for our freedoms and prosperity, and not because of our deeply flawed foreign policy that has generated justifiable grievances and has inspired the radical violence against us. Without this understanding, our endless unnamed and undeclared wars will continue, and our wonderful experiment with liberty will end. And I yield back the balance of my...
I think it's just more of the same. It's more spending and more debt, and I don't think it'll solve the problem. It's turning the spending responsibilities over to government rather than individuals, and that's not the way you make an economy work. That's what we've been trying to do for years, and we've accelerated that in the last year. And it's just stumbling along. It reminds me of the 1930s. And we're going to spend a lot of time and a lot of money doing this, but it's not going to solve our problem. You know, they say that we're going to have trillion-dollar deficits for years to come. At the same time, we want to be fiscal conservatives and start talking about budgetary reforms. Like, changing the budget is a tactical thing, and it's only a budgetary problem. But to me, it's a philosophic problem. Why are we spending all this money? Why do we run the world empire, and why do we have a welfare state? And how did we get ourselves into this mess, and how did we allow this monetary system to do this to us? But we cannot solve our problem by doing exactly the same thing that got us into this mess.
This idea, Congressman Paul, of trillion-dollar deficits for years to come, it's almost like trillion has become the new billion. And if you say it quickly, maybe it doesn't hurt so much, but just how much pain could this leave for our children and grandchildren?
Well, you know, we talk about that a lot, and we should. But I'm afraid that this generation is going to suffer, because I think the confidence eventually will be lost. You know, if $2 trillion a year budget doesn't seem to quite work, and that's the tactic, why not have a $4 trillion? Eventually, the confidence will be lost. It'll be lost in the system. The financial system broke down because they lost confidence in it, because it was built on illusions. But soon, they're going to lose confidence in the dollar. Now, that'll be a crisis that'll be much bigger than the crisis we're facing today.
So if you were the president's chief economic advisor, or you were running the budget office, what would you do?
I would balance a budget, and I would tell people to save their money, and that we should cut spending. But where we would cut spending is not domestic. We spend over $1 trillion a year maintaining our world empire. We can afford to do less overseas, because what we do overseas just causes problems for us. The Soviet system came down because they overextended themselves in Afghanistan. They bankrupted that country. And actually, Osama bin Laden said, I'm going to bankrupt the Soviets, and they'll have to leave. And they did. Right. We're doing the same thing. But we're too extended. We could cut, balance the budget, cut spending, and let the people go back to work, go to savings, and let the market operate.
So, Dr. Paul, you obviously know a lot about economics. You know a lot about finance. But noted and Nobel Prize-winning economist Paul Krugman has said, we need to have a stimulus package. It needs to be a big stimulus package, and we need to have it quickly.
Well, yeah, he comes from a different view, but I doubt if he ever read Austrian economics. I don't even know if he knows who Mises is and Hayek and Rothbard, the people who talked about free market. He's not a free market person. Matter of fact, we haven't had free market policies in this country for a long, long time, because once you have a Federal Reserve system, they are the central economic planners. They manipulate the economy by artificially lowering interest rates. So the economists you hear from in our universities and in from Washington, D.C. are all interventionists. They're liberals, they're Keynesians. So if they're still winning the Nobel Prize for economics, then we're in serious trouble. But fortunately for us, there are a lot more people in this country who are waking up to the fact that the culprit is really the Federal Reserve, the monetary system, and this spendthrift Congress that we have and government. And once that's realized and we have enough people, it will change, because we can't continue to do what we're doing now. Well, something has to give.
Yeah, there's no question that this idea of running multi-year trillion-dollar deficits is more than just a little shocking.